Grid family, welcome back. So glad that you are here today. We know that there are literally thousands of churches you could be attending right now, but you're here and you're ready to receive and you're ready to engage. And for that, we are so grateful. I'm gonna turn it over to our team here in a few moments. They're gonna lead us in some awesome music, and then I'm gonna be back and I'm gonna preach about Jesus. And today, at the end of our talk, we're gonna give you an opportunity to receive Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. And if you do that, I personally want to know about it. We got a link down below. You can click that link to let me know, to let us know you made that decision. Hey, I'll be back in a few. Enjoy this music.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. And when the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. Oh my God, you never fail. Oh my God, we'll never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
you got a Bible? I hope you do. And if you do, open it up to the Gospel of Mark. Mark chapter 14, we're going to be picking it up in verse 53. Simply entitled today's talk, The Unjust Trial of Jesus. And we're going to be looking at that moment when Jesus was arrested and when he was tried, when he stood trial before the Jewish courts. In fact, not only did he stand one trial, he stood the course of six trials over the course of one night. The most unfair, the most illegal, the most unjust trial, not only of Jesus' day, but really of human history. And it's so fascinating to me because the Jewish people prided themselves on being people of integrity, on being astute to the law, on upholding the law, and on being integrous in every aspect of the law. And yet here they are performing one of the most illegal acts, not only of their day, but of all time. What's so interesting to me is that if you're a history buff, you know that our country was founded on Judeo-Christian values. Many of our founding fathers were evangelical Christian men. And as a result of that, our country was founded on biblical values. And it's so interesting because the story we're about to read, we're going to find so many similarities between not only Jesus' judicial system, the judicial system of Jesus' day, but our judiciary today. It's so fascinating to me as we kind of look at these similarities between ours and Jesus' day. It's so fascinating to me. Let me give you an example in Deuteronomy chapter 16. This is what it says. Appoint judges and officials for each of your tribes in every town the Lord your God is giving you, and they shall judge the people fairly. Verse 19, do not pervert justice or show partiality. Do not accept a bribe, for a bribe blinds the eyes of the wise and twists the words of the innocent. Verse 20, follow justice and justice alone. Just so we can kind of set the background for what we're about to read, let me kind of give you a background of what the judiciary was like in Jesus' day. So what the Jewish people did with this particular premise we just read in Deuteronomy was, within each town, they would set up a council of men. It'd be made up of elders and priests and well-respected men in that community. They called it the Sanhedrin or the Sanhedrin. And it'd be made up of an odd number, 23 to be exact, so that when they would hear cases would be brought before them, they wouldn't have a split decision, but they'd always have a majority vote. And they would hear cases, cases would come before them as a court. They'd be the judge and the jury. If, for an example, the particular Sanhedrin of that local town couldn't come to a fair and an equitable decision, they would then escalate the case to Jerusalem, to a council, again, another council called the Great Sanhedrin, which would be equivalent to our Supreme Court today. This particular council was made up of 70 men, and again, these men would be elders, and this time they'd be priests, they'd be chief priests, and they'd also be made up of the high priest. So you'd have 70 men plus the high priest, again, an odd number, so that you'd never have a split decision, you'd always have a majority vote. And again, their job was to hear cases that were escalated from the local towns around the area and offer a fair and an equitable decision. And you would think that if you were in the hands of the Great Sanhedrin, that you'd be in great hands, you'd be in great company, and you'd know that you're gonna get a fair decision and an equitable decision, not only for you, but for your particular case. This was not so with Jesus, and we're gonna come to find out he stood trial between all these different, you know, court systems, and this was the last place that Jesus was safe. You see, it's so interesting the similarities between the judicial system of Jesus' day and ours today. Within Jesus' judiciary, within the judicial system of Jesus' day, they had an individual had three guarantees. The first guarantee was that they were to have a public trial, not ever a secret trial, never to be done at night, never to be done in secret. The second guarantee was that they were to be offered a public defender, right? If someone gets arrested today, they're read their Miranda rights. As part of the Miranda rights, they're offered an attorney. If you cannot afford an attorney, one will be appointed for you. Same thing in Jesus' day. And the third guarantee was that they could only be convicted on the testimony of two or three witnesses. So if you go and you murder somebody and there's only one witness and the witness comes forward and says, I saw him murder that person, and there's only one witness, well, you're free. three. There's no guarantee, you will not be convicted. It has to be two or three witnesses. And in Jesus' day, if you were convicted of a capital punishment, one involving the death penalty, you couldn't be convicted and executed on the same day. There had to be one full day lapse between your conviction and your actual execution. And the purpose was of this was for the court, for the elder, for the council of men, the council to fast. That way any additional evidence could come forward. That way they could fast and say, God, help us to discern this case. If there's any additional witnesses to come forward, that way there was never a moment where you were convicted and executed in the same moment. There was a day lapse in between so that additional witnesses, additional information could come in. So you would think that if you were in the hands of the great Sanhedrin, the Supreme Court of Jesus' day, that you'd be in good hands. This is a safe place for you to be, where you're going to get a fair decision. You're going to get an equitable decision for not only yourself, but for the entire land. This was not so in Jesus' case. This was the last place that Jesus would have been safe. Jesus' trials were a complete mockery of justice of his day. Not only of his day, but of our day today. And there are multiple reasons why. The court was to have an arraignment prior to the trial, right? The moment where you come in and the court says, these are the charges being brought against you. Never happened with Jesus. No trial was to be conducted at night. All of his trials were conducted at night. Remember, he left Jerusalem. He goes to the Garden of Gethsemane. It's late at night. He's praying, and that's when he is arrested. And all of his trials happen over the course of the night. The third reason, no trial was to be done in secret. All of his were. Witnesses were to give the time and the place of the crime against that person. Never happened with Jesus. And the fifth reason was, before condemning a man, a judge was to fast, or the judges were to fast for a day. They didn't do that. It's a complete mockery of their judiciary, of the entire judicial system, but they hated Jesus. They wanted him dead. Now, all of that serves really as a backdrop to what we're going to read today. So Mark chapter 14, pick it up, verse 53 says this, and they led Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests and all the elders and all the scribes came together. Now, just a brief primer here. Mark, remember Mark, he's the ADD gospel writer, just one thing to another, action-packed. His favorite word is immediately. So Mark doesn't actually give us the first three phases of Jesus' trial. You can find those first three phases in John chapter 18, but Mark just skips straight to the juicy part. He goes to Annas, he goes to Caiaphas, they question him about his disciples, they question him about his teaching. They want to just find any charge against Jesus. They got to find something, because this guy is spotless. He's perfect. There's no flaw that they can find in this guy, but they got to find something. They find nothing. They beat him up a little bit, and then they escalate him on. So back to Mark. Mark chapter 14, verse 54 says this, and Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards and warming himself at the fire. This is interesting to me, because Peter hasn't yet denied the Lord. He's deserted him, but he hasn't yet denied the Lord. He loves the Lord. He loves Jesus. He just doesn't want to be around Jesus in this moment. And my question for you is this a picture of your relationship with Jesus? Where maybe on Sunday you have no problem being in church. On Sunday you have no problem watching church online. But throughout the course of the week, you want nothing to do with Jesus. No doubt Peter loved Jesus. It's evident he was around Jesus. He just didn't want to be near Jesus in this moment. And maybe that's a picture of your life. You love the Lord, but you only love him when it's convenient for you. You don't want anything to do with the Lord when it's kind of inconvenient for you. And if you notice, if you're not walking really, really close to Jesus, you find yourself hanging around the wrong people altogether. Here we see Peter. He is near Jesus, just not really, really close. But he's very, very close to the guards, the people who are actually going to end up abusing Jesus and ultimately killing Jesus. Verse 55, now the chief priest and the whole council were seeking testimony against Jesus to put him to death. But they found none. Zero. Nada. They found nothing. There's no arraignment. There are no allegations. They can't get any charge that will actually stick to put Jesus to death. They got absolutely nothing here. Verse 56, for many bore false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. And some stood up and bore false witness against him, saying, we heard him say, I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another, not made with hands. Yet even this testimony did not agree. Maybe you say, you know, is this really a big deal? Well, in the ancient Roman world, it was a massive deal. Any threat against the place of worship, against the synagogue, was punishable by capital punishment, by the death penalty. So if anybody, right, were to have a threat against a synagogue or against a place of worship, immediately you were convicted, you were tried, and you were sentenced to death. So yeah, it's a very, very massive deal. But yet nobody can get their story together. All these false witnesses coming up, you would think that they kind of get a group of people together and say, hey, look, let's just all get together and say Jesus threatened a temple, right? And then we'll all just kind of agree on a time and a place, on a date, right? That all happened. But they couldn't get their testimony together. Nothing actually could stick here. They couldn't find any charge against Jesus. All of their testimonies were false and they could not agree. Verse 60, and the high priest stood up in the midst and asked Jesus, have you no answer to make? Jesus is just standing there silent. What is it that these men testify against you? The high priest is looking for something from Jesus. He's just standing there silently, right? He's looking for something. Maybe Jesus will incriminate himself. Maybe he will say, yeah, I did say that. Maybe something. They got to find something. And yet there is nothing. And the high priest is frustrated and Jesus is silent. Look at it here, verse 61. But he remained silent and made no answer. This is the silence of integrity. This is the silence of the one who is ultimately in control of the entire situation that is seemingly chaotic. And the high priest asked him, are you the Christ? Are you the Son of the Blessed? And now what the high priest is doing, now he is appealing God, very God. He is putting Jesus under oath and he is saying, are you the Messiah? Are you the one? We have heard you claim that you are the Messiah, the Son of God. Are you the Son of God? Look at it, verse 62. And Jesus said, I am. There it is right there. To the critic who says that Jesus never claimed to be God, this is it right here. This is that moment. I am. The very name of God, very God, the most holy name in the universe. This is Yahweh. This is Jehovah. This is the Lord, capital L-O-R-D. This is God, very God. And Jesus is now making the declaration that I am He. I am the Son of God. I am God, very God. And he goes on, he says, I am. But he doesn't stop there. He continues on and he says, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven. Jesus is saying, this isn't the last time that you're going to see me either. I am coming again. But the next time I come, I am not coming as the Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world. The next time you see me, I'm going to be coming on the clouds of glory as a mighty warrior, as a mighty conqueror to claim back what is rightfully mine. This isn't the last time you're going to see me. I am God, very God, and I am here now, and I will die and be raised again and be ascended into heaven, but I am coming again. I am. The moment Jesus breaks his silence, he breaks his silence by saying, I am God. And the high priest tore his garments and he said, what further witness do we need? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision? And they all condemned him as deserving death. Why was Jesus crucified? He was crucified because he claimed to be God. And he was. This is why Jesus was crucified. They didn't believe he was God, and yet he claimed to be God. Well, newsflash, he was God, and he is God. Verse 65. And some began to spit on him and to cover his face and to strike him, saying to him, prophesy. I mean, can you imagine this scene that they are now in the presence of their Supreme Court of their day? And there is upheaval and there is attacking of the particular person on trial here. They are spitting on him. They are beating him. They are slapping him. We know from other gospels that they blindfolded him. They began beating him. They began pulling out his beard. They began punching him and they began saying, prophesy, son of God, who hit you? So he's blindfolded. They're smacking him around and saying, who hit you? Prophesy. And the guards received him with blows. And we know how the story ends. This is just getting started. He is just kind of receiving the beginnings of the torture and the punishment that he will endure. As we read all this, you know, maybe the question is good for us to ask, what exactly is this saying to us today? And I think there's a few things that we can take away and apply to our life today. And the first thing is this, is that Jesus was innocent. And I think it's important that you and I remember that. Maybe a better way to say that is Jesus was perfect. He was the perfect Lamb of God. And from the moment he was born to the moment we are reading right now, where he is put on trial and treated unfairly and abused in front of the entire Supreme Court of his day and all the people there watching, he remained perfect. He remained innocent. Just imagine the scene that even if you, a good person, right, are standing trial, you were blindfolded and you began being beat by the crowd. Imagine the sinful nature within you, within me, kind of raging up, kind of in that moment wanting to retaliate, wanting to curse people, wanting to kind of retaliate and kind of defend yourself. And Jesus doesn't do that. He remained perfect. He remained innocent because the price of your sin and the price of my sin was a perfect Lamb of God, a perfect and a spotless Lamb. And Jesus was that. He was perfect. He was innocent. There's a second thing that we need to remember, that we need to apply to our life today. The second thing is this: you and I, we're guilty. We're the guilty ones. He took our place. He took our punishment. He took on what we deserve. We deserved the cross. We deserved the punishment. We deserved the beating. We deserved everything that Jesus endured here and that he will endure in the next coming hours. We deserved it all, and yet Jesus took our place. We are all guilty. And in that moment when God furiously poured out his wrath upon the perfect and the spotless Lamb of God, in that moment, he made it possible for you and for I, when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, to have life and life everlasting. We are guilty, and yet we are made perfect by the perfect, spotless sacrifice of Jesus Christ, who died in your place, who died in my place. We were guilty. We were guilty, but now we stand innocent because Jesus took our place. We were guilty. We were guilty. It was our punishment that Jesus died for, but he died for you, and Jesus paid it all. Last thing is this, is that every person must judge Christ. And you say, what do you mean by that? You have to decide, is Jesus the Son of God or isn't he? Is Jesus actually God or isn't he? And if you determine in your mind that Jesus is the Son of God, then you have to take it a step further and say, if Jesus is actually God, do I believe him? And if I believe that he is God, then the next question is, am I actually going to bow my knee to him? You know, Jesus even says, he says, I am the way, I'm the truth, and I am the life. No person comes to the Father except through me. And if that actually is true, if no one comes to the Father but by Jesus, then the next question for you is, do I actually believe that? Do I actually accept Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior? Do I accept him as my Lord and as my Savior? Will I bow my knee to him? Because ultimately, what you decide to do with Jesus is ultimately going to decide what you do with your eternity. Jesus is God, very God. And he came to this earth and he put on human flesh and he died for your sins and he died for my sins, that one day you too and I too will stand before the one who died for us. We'll stand before, and he will look at you and he will say, well done, my good and my faithful servant. God, very God, put on flesh and he came to this earth, died for you, was buried, rose again, ascended into heaven, and is coming back again to take you, to take me, to be with heaven. Ultimately, what you decide to do with Jesus will ultimately decide what you do with your eternity. Let's pray. God, we love you. We're so grateful that you came and you put on human flesh. Jesus, you walked to this earth and you lived a perfect life and you died for the sins of all mankind. And today, God, we need you. You know, maybe you're watching right now and you'd say, you know, I've never made Jesus the Lord and Savior of my life. Or maybe for you, it's been a really, really long time. I'm gonna pray a prayer and I'd invite you to pray it along with me. Let me just make it clear that a prayer doesn't save you, but the Bible does say that if you pray this prayer, you confess it with your mouth and you believe it in your heart, then you're saved. You're a child of the living God. So all together, we'll just say this, say, Jesus, I need you. Jesus, I need your forgiveness and I need your grace. I need you in my life. I thank you for living a perfect life and for dying for my sin. Save me, forgive me, and free me. Fill me with your spirit, I pray. I'm a child of God now and forever. Amen and amen. Come on, wherever you're at, would you just give God some praise in this place?
See the light tearing.
Thank you. Thanks for hanging with us today online. We know that doing church online is a little bit different than what we're all used to, but you're here and you're still here. And maybe you're checking us out for the first time. We got all the info linked down below. Text that number, click that link. We want to hear from you, but more importantly, we want to hear about you. We want to do life with you. So thanks for checking us out. If you're giving, thank you. It's making a massive difference. We have been able to provide groceries, pay bills, bless people in our church, in our community, in our city, and globally. And it's because you are a giving church. We got all the info down at the bottom of your screen. Keep on being faithful. Keep on blessing. Keep on giving because we are able to bless so many. Grid fam, we love you and we're praying for you. We'll hang out all week long online, but until then, stay safe. Stay healthy. Praying for you. We'll be right back.
Thank you.